With a degree in philosophy, you have something which, and just because, as the ancients once defined it, you can do nothing practical, philosophy, it is said, bakes no bread. But as a result, philosophy has no limits. And that means that you graduates with a degree in philosophy are unlimited. Even more than your fellow graduates in other fields, you truly can do anything you choose. Yes, you really can. Notice that I am not here declaring that you have learned critical thinking, though I'm sure that you have. I do not equate philosophy with critical thinking, and part of my reason is that I am battle shy or weary as a college professor who has patiently listened to too many colleagues in the natural and social sciences and in the humanities and in media studies and even in the arts insist that their disciplines too teach critical thinking. I am sure my colleagues are right. And I think all of you are well aware that critical thinking is part of the inevitably interdisciplinary college package. Philosophy is all about the ability to make distinctions, as my European professors would always insist, usually in Latin. And because this is a paper, I have a long footnote here, which I won't read, citing Aquinas, who cites Aristotle's De Anima, Descartes, Robert Sokolowski, those of you who have iPhones and want to Google it, as an article, The Method of Philosophy Making Distinctions, and Hannah Arendt, who defends a criticism of her Men in Dark Times by an article in the New York Review of Books entitled Distinctions. And I think all philosophers of any stripe can agree on this. But I would add that it also means that philosophy promises, which is to say that it doesn't always deliver, a certain refinement, a certain intellectual class, knowing, for better or for worse, what can be known and the limitations of claims to knowledge, a knowledge which includes aesthetic sensibility, ethical know-how, but also, to get back to Nietzsche, style. You now find yourself here at this moment to be recognized for your achievements, which is what it is to have a degree conferred upon you, to be urged to celebrate by the same family and friends that surround you with not a little nostalgia and with an unmistakable joy. Joy. Note the word, note the sentiment. If I had access to a kind of acoustic or musical PowerPoint, I'd play a small bit from Beethoven's Ninth, just the word for which alone Beethoven was justified in favoring Schiller above Goethe and every other German poet, for its melic and tonic power, Freude, joy. Commencement occasions are astonishingly happy times for all the effort the university puts into getting one last shot at boring you with commencement address after commencement address, watching the formal progression of others, hearing about degrees and titles, having the events of the day explained again and again in a way that your professors have for 4 years tried to marry the timeless with the currently fashionable. Be joyful. Celebrate this day. It's a rare day. Even if you collect college degrees like stamps, it will never be possible for you to have very many of them. And unlike a birthday, unlike New Year's Eve, you have earned it. You have the right to celebrate. A university degree gives you that right. For some, it'll be the right to go on to graduate or professional study. For some, the right to take a bit of time off for the best year of your life, try to turn it into two or three, traveling in Europe, in the Far East, and so on, or will be the right to a career, an internship or professional position, one you have perhaps already accepted. For many of you, it will be a combination of these things, either at once or serially, sometimes planned, sometimes unpredictably so. But in any case, what you inherit with this right is also a title to a lifetime of learning. And if that is to say, and if you kind of guessed I would say it, a lifetime of loving wisdom, there is also no better life than that. Sapere aude, dare to know. But that means, and so Socrates, who was mentioned at the start, dare to take the risk that is involved in exposing oneself to being amazed. That wonderful Greek word that goes along with philosophy from the start, thamaten, as Plato also calls this the inception, the beginning, the commencement of philosophy. Be astonished, but also, and this is harder, stay astonished at the wonder of life and its richness, and that includes having a care to note its frailties and commemorating its losses, but also being attuned to its glories and its beauty. And notice one last thing. If this were a different economic time, I could end by emphasizing philosophy's practical side once again. For all its anxieties, some will say because of these, an advantage of living in the uncertain times in which we find ourselves is that we are invited to note the extraordinary things that everyday distractions usually obscure. Thus, I suggest that you go for the real gold of life, that you go for joy. Congratulations to all of you. Congratulations, fellow colleagues, and to parents and friends for accompanying these graduates to this point and beyond. Above all, congratulations to you as graduates of the class of 2009. The best future is the one that is yours. Seize and love each day, beginning with the joy of this day of celebration and beginning. They are your days. Farewell, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Babich. We also have a number of baccalaureate awards to hand out today to the graduates. And for those, I introduce David Dilworth, our Director of Undergraduate Studies.